With us on Live It Up is one of the first friends that I met when I moved to Long Island about 20 years ago. It's Randy Jackson. Welcome to the show. How are you?
I'm doing great, Donna. How are you?
Good. So we just got reacquainted actually recently at Dee Snider's motorcycle ride, mm-hmm. which is great, doing things for charity. You always seem to be super philanthropic. How did you learn that? How did that come about in your life to want to give back?
I just think I probably got that from my parents, you know. My parents were both attorneys, but they, my mother was a law clerk. My father was, he had started a pension business, and they were always giving back to the community and involved locally, politically in New Orleans. And it was about trying to help people out, you know, and I was really drawn to that. And I, you know, learned by example. They were great examples for me, you know, and it just seems natural, you know. It's, you know, what I do. I feel like I'm really fortunate to be able to do what I do. And it's not too hard to come out and just, you know, play a couple of songs for people. Nobody has to like, oh, come on, man, can you do it? No, it's a lot of fun, especially when you have friends like Dee who, you know, are fun to be with. And
yeah, it was a great day.
It's a no-brainer.
It was a beautiful day, you know, lots of good sunshine, so everybody was happy. Now, what's interesting about you too, Randy, is that 12 strings,
uh-huh.
right? So how did that process begin for you? How did you become, you know, playing on a 12-string guitar?
I think it started when Zebra first got together back in 1975, and we were learning some cover tunes, and we came to learning the Rain Song by Led Zeppelin, and there was also Stairway to Heaven, and you could tell there was something going on there. You know, they had a 12-stringer, they were using something that was making it sound like that, and that was kind of what led me to it. But what got me, I mean, I really don't even play six strings anymore. I just play 12-string now, just because it sounds so much bigger, and I think it's more dynamic for me, you know. And it, you know, you play it the same way. You just gotta, you know, push a little bit harder, you know. But I love the sound. So
yeah, it's absolutely beautiful. You said that you would play something for us. What did you select today?
I'm gonna do Who's Behind the Door.
Excellent. Okay. Thank you. nice.
Thanks.
Randy Jackson. Woo! Nice.
Thanks.
Oh, my goodness gracious. Wow. So I was telling some friends backstage that the very first time I ever saw you play was at a small little brewery, microbrewer kind of place, winery place in Westbury. And a lot of people have been following you for a long time here in Long Island. This was like such a treat. Like, I was blown away. I'm like, wow, my hands started getting sweaty. Oh. I was like, wah! Beautiful.
Thank you.
Really, really beautiful.
Thanks.
So now you were talking about only playing 12 strings guitars, and this particular guitar is a
D'Angelico.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
But somebody's helping you build another guitar. What is that guitar that you're?
Michael Kelly.
Okay.
Yeah, and we're designing a 12 string, and it's in the demo stages right now, and I'm playing out a little bit with it, but it had dirty strings on it, so I wanted to bring a clean guitar to the show.
Yeah. Well, we appreciate you cleaning up for us.
Yeah, as much as possible, you know. I'm on the road a lot.
Uh-huh.
But yeah, I'm looking forward to it. It doesn't have a hole in the middle. There's holes on the top.
Okay.
So the person playing it can hear better.
Oh, interesting.
And then there's one over here. Yeah, it's an interesting design.
Okay.
And it's a beautiful guitar. The wood is just off the
spectacular
charts.
Yeah, well, congratulations. Really, wish you all the best of luck with that. That's really cool.
Thanks.
You got a really interesting gig coming up back down south, Louisiana.
Yeah.
Tell us about that.
Well, Zebra is going to perform with a symphony orchestra, and we're so excited about it. You know, a lot of the Zebra music, especially the third album, a lot of the first album, is, you know, kind of lends itself to being orchestrated. And the conductor, Brent Havens, who I've been working with for about 22 years, doing different shows around the country with orchestras, we decided to do a show where we're going to do half Zebra and half Led Zeppelin. So we're going to be playing with the Acadiana Symphony, and we're going to have Felix and Guy,
know,
the whole Zebra band, playing the show. And the first half's going to be all Zebra, and then the second half's Led Zeppelin. And the great part about it for me is that some of the songs we're going to be doing, we've never played live ever.
Really?
Yeah, we're going to be doing like three songs that we've never done live. And so it's going to be
a
lot of fun. So we're practicing.
Yeah, there you go. And when you practice, what do? Do you meet in somebody's garage? I mean, are you doing it like that again,
it's not
or
in
no?
The garage.
Okay.
You know, I'll sit around with an acoustic guitar, and Felix will come over with his bass, and we'll plug it into a little speaker about this big, and we'll be in the living room doing
it. I love that.
You know, and if Guy's around, he'll just tap on, you know,
whatever's there. Yeah. Right. I'll like ding, 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 ding.
Yeah,
right.
Exactly.
So the journey has been wonderful for you. So you were saying earlier in the interview that you were the son of people that had like regular day jobs.
Yep.
Right. What was that moment like for your family when you decided to become a musician and you started making money at it when you were like working?
Well, I think they were relieved.
Were they?
They were always very supportive.
Okay.
You know, they took my brother and I to see the Beatles in 1964. So that was my first concert. And I was like, said, wow, it's not just like Huckleberry Hound. This is the real thing, you know, this is the real deal. And I was pretty impressed. And then I just started to love music, you know. My first introduction was the Beatles. And I'm a huge Beatle fan, always have been. And, you know, so when my parents, you know, saw me making money, they were like, wow, this is good. But interesting enough, my father wasn't totally convinced that this would be career worthy. So
okay.
he hired somebody from the Dallas Morning News, believe it or not, a music critic, to come down and, you know, secretly like review our shows in Louisiana, because he wanted to know whether this was really going to work out or not, you know. And I didn't know about it until afterwards, of course, but you know, when I found out, I thought it was pretty interesting. But evidently she gave us a stellar review, and you know, so he was sold on it, you know.
Any highlights of the journey so far that, like, when you go to bed at night sometimes you kind of like reminisce about, that stick out for you personally?
You mean in the career itself, or just during the time period?
Oh, either way.
Yeah.
Special moments for you along the songbook of your life, in a way.
I think. Well, I mean, of course, there's that Beatles show. You know, that first concert. You know, that was really. It was. It's one thing that I'll never forget. I think working with Jack Douglas, you know, was another moment along with that. Jack had produced John Lennon, and you know, so I got to hear a lot of stories about, you know, my one of my heroes. And and he was great to work with also. We played a show with Journey where they gave us the keys to the city in New Orleans, and I remember that.
Your hometown,
our
right?
Our hometown, yeah. And then being inducted into the Long Island Music Hall of Fame and the Louisiana Music Hall of Fame. Those were big events, yeah.
Lovely. Lovely. And you've got, and you play, you do gig. You play a lot. You're on the road a lot still.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And luckily, I can still, you know, hit the notes. And,
you can. And
knock,
that was it.
Knock on wood, and I'll just keep playing, you know. I mean, that's where the majority of my income is from performing live, you know. And it's fun. We, you know, I enjoy doing it, and it's great that the fans still come to see Zebra, and, you know, we're happy, you know, that.
And you have
they're
your own,
still there.
And you really do have your own sound. Like, and I guess you just play all the time, so you don't really need to like warm up or anything. You just
I do warm up.
Do you?
Up.
How do you?
Yeah.
Like,
I actually warmed up before I came here.
You did?
Yeah, my
okay.
Warm up my voice.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
La 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 la.
Yeah, I do scales and stuff. You know, ha ha ha. Andy Felice. Yeah, I went to a vocal coach back in the 80s.
Okay.
After the first two Zebra records,
really?
Believe it or not.
And then
not.
You
yeah.
went.
And then I went because I wasn't happy with the result I was getting in the studio. When I'd go back in and listen, I said, this doesn't sound like what I thought I was singing. And he said, you know, I'm going to fix your pitch. You know, it's about the scales. And it sure was. You know, mm-hmm. 6 months later, I was in the studio and like, wow.
And also, as a singer, I know, too, that a lot of times people are worried because, like, this is your also your other instrument. And you have to, like, maintain it. You have to drink water. You have to be able to, like you said, vocalize. And you don't want to get hoarse. You don't want it to, like, kick out on you.
No.
So
you use it is what you do. So you want to exercise every day. So I try to vocalize every day. Even though, you know, when I'm not playing, I'll do the exercises and stuff. And that helps to keep the voice in good shape. If you lay off too long and you try to, it's just like
you're
being
rusty.
A football player, yeah. Trying to throw a football after you haven't thrown one in 6 months. Not fun.
Not going to happen.
No.
Who's inspirational to you now? Whose sound do you kind of like?
You know, I mean, I think all of us are like products of our teenage years. And so when I listen to newer stuff, I'm hearing that it seems there's a little bit of derivativeness from, you know, from anything that I hear. I haven't heard anything in the rock scene that's really, really new. So I go back and I listen to the Pink Floyd and the Moody Blues, and those were my favorites, where they had a combination of great music and great lyrics, you know. And I mean, there's a couple of great bands out right now that are, you know, there's the Greta Van Fleet.
Okay.
I was talking about. And
yeah, we were talking backstage with that with Tony, our director.
Yeah. And funny enough, the guy who signed us to Atlantic Records, Jason Flom, we were the first band he signed. He signed Greta Van Fleet. And he said to me, yeah, he says, I started off with kind of a Zeppelin thing, and now I'm going to be ending with a Zeppelin thing. You know?
Probably use the same pen
awesome, you know?
For both. You never know, right?
You
always wonder about the people that actually, like, sign people.
Right.
Like, you know, do you have a certain set of pens that you're using? You know, I'd frame every one of them. And speaking of keepsakes along the way, is there anything from your Zebra journey that you've kept, that you framed, like a certain LP that you did? Is there any, like, memorabilia in your house that you personally keep?
There's a couple of things. There's a clear fleur-de-lis that somebody gave us that was like a plaque, and it really just looks awesome. And I think it was celebrating our 40th anniversary, and it looks nice. And 40 years, that's a long time.
That is.
You know, and so I like that. I mean, there's a lot of stuff. I got too much stuff at my
you
house.
Do?
People give me Zebra stuff all the time.
There
it's
you
like,
go.
Where am I going to put it? You know, you need a warehouse for all this stuff, you know?
Well, someday when it's Graceland, you never know. And people are going to pay it for tickets to go visit. They'll be like, he mentioned the fleur-de-lis. You know, fleur-de-lis I like because I grew up in St. Louis, Missouri.
Yeah.
So, you know, same thing with me. They're just beautiful.
Yeah,
so.
They really are. St. Louis is an awesome town.
Great. And anything you'll play out for us as we're closing the...
Sure.
In the segment, that would be great. Please listen in as Randy is going to play us out. Bye. Randy Jackson.